Welcome to Kingdom Insights. I'm Putty Putman, the founding director of the School of Kingdom Ministry, and we, with Kingdom Insights, are just creating a series of interviews, of DVDs, where I'm just sitting down, talking with people who are just seeing the stuff happen in their lives, in their ministries, and the idea is to just kind of create some tools for just us on the journey, to gain perspective from those who have gone ahead of us, and to just equip all of us. And so today I'm sitting down with my friend Brian Blount, who is a really interesting guy. He's a power evangelist, has been in power evangelism for a long time, 15 years,
15
right?
Years,
15
yeah.
years. And co-authored a book on it called From the Sanctuary to the Streets. And what I really love about Brian, and we'll get to in this interview as you'll see, is Brian actually does not work for a church. I mean, he has powerful power evangelism ministry, but he's a normal guy. He runs a graphic design business, and he's the epitome of everybody gets to play, because he's an everybody, and yet God is using him powerfully. And so I'm really excited for this interview. Thanks for being with us, Brian.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
And let's just jump right in. So,
absolutely.
Brian, what would you say is like the main thrust of your ministry? What's your thing?
Yeah, that's a good question. You know, I really think this is that the kingdom of God is at hand. No matter what, and or no matter where. And I think we're trying to put God in the box all the time, but it, really, truly, that God is ruling, God is reigning, His kingdom has come, and His kingdom is coming. And so that's really my simple message, is that the kingdom of God's at hand, no matter what, and our job is simply to look, listen, and respond.
Okay, yeah, great.
That's
great.
Kind of the thrust of my my message, my idea.
Cool. And you know, tell us about that. How did that come about? How did you get started with that?
Yeah.
Where does that come from?
Absolutely. Well, so I, you know, started getting, I had a really crazy encounter with the Holy Spirit early on, and saw God just come and break in, and it really awakened my heart that God was really pursuing me, that God was really pursuing us, and that the kingdom was at hand. Even in places that maybe people didn't want them. I was a part of a youth camp ministry for a while, and helped out kind of as a camp counselor during the summer.
Yeah.
And what happened was there was a group of kids that were there that were kind of just kind of on the fringe. And it was in a very traditional type setting of a church. And what I saw was, during one of the services, just the Spirit of God come in so powerfully and so strong that kids began to just experience renewal. They began to experience deliverance and began to experience freedom as just the Holy Spirit just came and touched them. It was an amazing thing. And I thought, man, if God could come to a place that that wasn't the tradition, and a lot of actually the pastors and leaders of this group, we're pretty opposed to the outpouring of the Spirit. And so it put a hunger in me. I thought, you know, if God could come to a place where people didn't seem to want Him, how much could He come to a place that people did want Him? And so that kind of put me on the pursuit that God was active and He was moving, and I really wanted to know more about the Holy Spirit. And finally found myself into the Vineyard movement and began to learn that anybody could do this stuff, that we were all called to heal the sick, we're called to hear God's voice, we're called to even raise the dead, and put me on this pursuit of learning to really how to partner with God. If the kingdom was at hand, what did that mean for my life? What did it mean for my everyday life? And how was I going to respond to that? And so I started pursuing just listening for God, looking for, you know, where His activity was, and just started seeing lots of crazy things begin to happen in my life.
So tell us about how, like, the beginning of that started. Like, how did you begin to experiment, you know, outside the building and so forth? What was that process?
Absolutely. So actually, that happened here in Illinois. I went to a Blaine Cook conference. And I'd heard about Blaine for years in the Vineyard, and he was probably one of the only guys that I'd heard taking the gospel outside the four walls of the church. And so I had this fascination. I thought, man, I wanted to get around someone like that. I wanted to get around a practitioner, someone that was really doing this stuff, not just, you know, we'd seen the theological table had been kind of set. I wanted to taste the meal. You know, I wanted to get in there and see what did it look like outside the four walls of the church. I'd been seeing I had that power encounter that I told you about with the Holy Spirit coming upon the youth, and then started to see like a lot of words of knowledge and healings that were happening in the church, and that was amazing. But there was this thing in me, is like, God, this is good, but I think it's supposed to be a lot better out here. And so at that time, there wasn't, like I said, a lot of guys that were doing it. And so when I heard Blaine was going to be here in the Illinois area, I drove from Oklahoma City, about a 15-hour drive, actually was around the Chicago area. And I thought, man, maybe I could just get around the atmosphere. Maybe something would happen. And to my surprise, I was in the meeting. Blaine calls me out and said, God's going to use you powerfully in power evangelism. Power of God came on me. I shook, fell to the ground. And I said, Lord, just give me an opportunity. I want to see this stuff happen now. I mean, you've called me out, but now let me see it in practice. So I had to go to lunch that day. I went to Popeye's Chicken. And walked in, and I was familiar again with the words of knowledge and hearing God's voice, but mainly in the context of the four walls of the church. And so we walked into Popeye's Chicken. All of a sudden, I had this sensation, like a sympathy pain type thing of a word of knowledge, like shoot down my left arm. And I thought, okay, the Lord's speaking to me about this lady that was standing in the line, getting ready to order. And then I was completely petrified. I was like, this isn't God. How could this be God? I mean, I traveled 15 hours. I'd prayed. I asked God for an encounter. You know, I got wanted to get around Blaine Cook because he was doing the stuff. And he calls me out, a hero in the faith, calls me out, says, God's going to use you powerfully in power evangelism. And here I am in my moment of encounter, and I am the biggest chicken in Popeye's Chicken. And so I stand there, and I just look at the lady, and a buddy of mine's with me, and he comes up and said, Brian, what's going on? He could tell there was something perplexing me. I said, I think God might be speaking to me. He said, well, go over there and talk to her. I said, no way. What if it's not God? He said, Brian, we drove 15 hours. You prayed and asked God for an encounter. I mean, Blaine calls you out. I mean, you had this encounter, and now you're standing right here at a moment in time where you can see the kingdom outside the four walls of the church. I said, no, I'm not going to do it. And so my buddy said, all right, if you're not going to do it, I'm going to go up and do it. I said, fine, one condition. He said, what's that? I said, you can't tell her it came from me. So he walks over to the lady, taps her on the shoulder, and said, hey, ma'am, you're having a pain in your left arm going down your arm, a radiating pain. She said, I'm having a pain in my left shoulder going down my arm. It's radiating pain. He said, if you let me pray for her, you'll get healed. So he prays for her right there on the spot. She gets healed. And I was like, dude, you're a jerk. You just stole my encounter. No, and that's how I start. I jokingly say that. But I was so scared to start out in praying for the sick outside the four walls, even though it was my passion in my heart. And that's how I got started in power evangelism.
So it's interesting. So Blaine calls you out, prays for you, and immediately activates it. But at the same time, you kind of had to develop courage to follow through for the gift that immediately began functioning. That's incredible. And so tell me about that. Like, how did that process of developing courage and kind of getting comfortable in that place, how did that work for
you? That took a little bit of a time. Actually, you know, God's so good about giving us other opportunities. And so it was probably about a month later, we were walking through Walmart, and I was with a buddy of mine. And we were looking for, I think, fishing equipment is what we were doing, and just kind of hanging out at Walmart, talking. And all of a sudden, this Walmart employee comes up, and he's asking if we need any help. And I said, no, we don't need any help. And we're just kind of going about our day, just hanging out. And he was really persistent with me. And I was kind of like getting a little bit irritated with him, honestly. And I said, hey, no, listen, man, we're just kind of hanging out, really don't need your help. And he just kept being persistent. So being the good Christian I am, I turned around and said, hey, man, why don't you just get lost? Now, I know that's, you guys are more holier than I am, probably, and wouldn't do that. But immediately when he walks off, this pain shot through my eyes. And the Lord said, this man has a problem with his eyes, has an irritation, I want you to pray for him. I said, I'm not going to do this.
You burned your bridge, man.
Yeah, I burned my bridge. I'm like, I'm going to make it harder on myself, you know. But then I remembered Popeye's Chicken. I thought, man, I want to be a chicken. So I thought, well, how am I going to go and now approach this guy because I just was a jerk to him? And so now, I mean, it made it worse. At first he was just with me. Now he's standing around with a whole bunch of Walmart employees. So I had to walk over to him and said, hey, excuse me, sir. I said, you're never going to believe this, but I'm a Christian. I'm a Christian jerk, actually. And he kind of laughed. And I said, hey, listen, when you walked away, I had this this sensation that you're having a problem with your eyes. You've been actually having this problem for about 2 weeks, this burning sensation. I said, if you let me pray for you, I believe God's going to heal you. He said, hey, I've been having this problem in my eyes for about 2 weeks. Yes, you can pray for me. Now, I was still a little bit of a chicken. because I didn't want to pray for him in front of everybody else. So I said, hey, can we go down an aisle where there's like nobody around? He said, sure. So we went down this aisle. And again, I didn't know how do you do this stuff. I mean, I've done it in the church, but I didn't do it outside the church. So I said, hey, man, close your eyes, open up your hands, assume the position. I'm just going to ask the Holy Spirit to come on you. I didn't know what to do. And I said, Holy Spirit, come. Now, I didn't learn this. I didn't hear this. Maybe I missed the class about when you ask the Holy Spirit to come in Walmart, what actually happens. And again, mind you, I was praying for his eyes. And I don't know if this is supposed to happen when you pray for the, you know, someone's eyes, but this is what happened. I said, Holy Spirit, come, just touch his eyes. And the guy begins to go, and starts to hyperventilate. And I had my buddy John with me. I just look at John, look at the guy, and I went, this is crazy. What is going on? So I didn't know, so I just started watching the guy. He's just sitting there, this hyperventilating, kind of, and shaking. So I said, hey, what's going on with you? He said, I can breathe. I said, I know you can breathe, man. I think the whole store can hear you breathe. I said, I wasn't praying for your breathing. I was praying for your eyes. He said, no, man, you don't understand. He said, I've had this condition in my lungs for about 2 months, and I haven't been able to breathe, and I am breathing well. I said, that's amazing. What about your eyes? I mean, I was, you know, curious about the eyes.
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
He goes, I can breathe. I said, I know you can breathe. What about your eyes? He goes, my eyes are fine too. And this is what I said to him. I said, man, I go, great. I guess it's a double bonus day for you. And I walked away shaking my head. Now you're thinking, dude, what an idiot. I said, I learned a valuable lesson the very first time I prayed for someone at, you know, Popeye's Chicken. I learned that the kingdom of God's at hand, no matter when you're a chicken. That day at Walmart, I learned a valuable lesson. The kingdom of God's at hand, even when you're a jerk and when you're stupid. You're thinking, man, you could have led the guy to Jesus. Yeah, hindsight's 20/20. I could have led the guy to Jesus. Yeah. But I didn't know what was going on. This just began just to kind of pursue me. I mean, I just began to see the activity of God's presence happening.
Yeah.
And me learning how to respond.
Right. So you would say then that like processing your first chicken experience helped you have courage to step out then in the future.
It did.
And then, so, I mean, do you still kind of go through that process where you're like, you kind of have to muster up courage to do it, or are you just comfortable in that place now, or what?
I've learned to put on a good game face. But in the inside, it's like I'm dying 1,000 deaths. It's like 1,000 butterflies are hitting my stomach. I'm scared. I'm nervous all the time. I don't think I've ever gotten past that.
Yeah.
To be honest.
Do you still chicken out sometimes? See an opportunity?
I do chicken out sometimes. I absolutely do. And probably less than I did in the beginning, but there's still those times. And you know, it's interesting. There was a time that I went out and saw all these like crazy healings. We went to a place called Grady Hospital in Atlanta, Georgia. It was just like, it's like fishing in a barrel. You know, it's just, it's like the modern day Pool of Bethesda. It's an amazing place. It's, you know, power evangelist guys would love it. There's just sick people everywhere, right? And so I went up and we saw these guys. I prayed for like three or four people right in a row that literally walked away carrying their canes in their hand. I mean, it was just one of those amazing encounters. And right after that, like nothing happened, and then power began to happen again. It was kind of a wild day. And I came back with all these stories. It was amazing. Next day I'm in Starbucks and I see a little old lady with a walker. And I was scared to death to go pray for her. I mean, here I was out, you know, a couple days before praying for Lucy and seeing all these crazy miracles. But when it came to Starbucks, and here's this little old lady, and I don't know if there was a spiritual dynamic that was there, if it was, I don't know, but it was just like I was petrified. I could not even get up to move to begin to even to speak to this little old lady. And here I was 2 days before with strangers that were in a very rough part of the city and seeing crazy things happen. So that happens from time to time. And I'm not really... I don't really know why.
You know? How would you counsel someone then who, you know, is kind of in the same place that you were, like want to see the signs and wonders, want to experience it outside the four walls of the church, but man, it's just scary. I don't know how to step out. You know, how what would you say to that person?
What would you say to that person? I think, you know, the only way that you're going to learn is by doing, and you really do have to. You know, faith is spelled R-I-S-K. That's the one thing we learned, you know, from John in the vineyard. And you're never really going to be able to. You got to kind of get past that. You just got to push, you know, ahead. You have to just step out. That's the only way you're going to see the inbreak of the kingdom come. And there, you know, I wish you could say it was just going to be easy, and you're not going to have fear, or you're not going to feel you get sick to your stomach, or you know, you're going to stutter or stammer through your words. I mean, I've had all that happen. you know. And so I would say, listen, you can, it's like use this analogy. It's like, oftentimes, you know, people talk about being the power evangelist, like the guys that jump in the deep into the pool, and the guys that are just kind of getting into the shallow in the pool, that's kind of like kiddie stuff, you know. And I said, listen, the goal is just get in the pool. It doesn't matter if it's the shallow end or if it's the deep end. You might get in the shallow end and think, man, this is awesome, but I want to be in the deep end. You may come into the deep end and go, I really like the shallow end. And to me, that's this. We couple a lot of things sometimes. We do, you know, just going about our day. Hey, why don't you just go to Walmart and you got to buy some milk, you got to buy some eggs. So while you're doing that, why don't you just begin to ask God to show you what's going on as you're out shopping? Or, you know, we do plan things, like we do some servant evangelism type things that we couple along with power evangelism. So we'll set up a table, we'll put, you know, bottles of water, some muffins and things like that. And as people come by, we say, hey, would you like a muffin? Would you like a glass of water? And then can we serve you in a practical way by praying for your spiritual needs? And we'll do that like usually in teams of people. So people that are new to it, they can hand out a bottle of water.
Sure.
So that's kind of helping them get into the, you know, basically get into the pool. So to speak. And then when they see somebody doing it, they're like, wow, I can do that too. And we help them kind of come in that way.
Yeah.
So that's one way to do it.
Okay. So you really see kind of a relationship between power evangelism and you know, say service evangelism, relational evangelism, other forms. You wouldn't pull them apart. You'd put them together.
No, I'd say you can couple them together. I think it's a mistake to just say, hey, it's just one way. I think, man, be creative and use whatever tool. Because people are, if you're really trying to equip somebody, if you're really trying to, at the end of the day, trying to empower somebody or to see the kingdom be released, then, I mean, throw away all the silliness of, hey, these guys are more mature. I mean, just couple everything together that you can be able to approach somebody in a real practical way where they feel honored, they feel loved, and people are being equipped and empowered, or the gospel's coming, you know, to reach them.
Could you just even take a few minutes and just share some of your favorite stories from the streets, just the stuff that even to this day blows your mind and you're like, what did that just happen?
I can think of a couple of some fun ones that happened. One recently was with my mom, and I love this story because it was with my mom, and my mom had been hearing a lot of stories about the kingdom and about healings happen, but she'd never seen it. And my mom and I had kind of a real rough relationship for many years. And so in the last about a year and a half, we've really kind of, God just has melted our hearts back together. And it's been awesome. And I've gotten an opportunity just to go serve her, just take her some places, you know, just to help her, you know, get around, do some errands and that, those kind of things. And so I was taking her, picking her up from the doctor and then taking her to get a prescription filled. So we pull up to Walgreens and, it was a nice sunny day there in Oklahoma. I had my window rolled down, and I looked over and I see this lady, and her window was rolled down in her car. And as soon as I pulled up, all of a sudden I had this sensation come all over the left side of my body, but it wasn't like this powerful sensation. It was more like a very fleeting kind of thought, but it got my attention. And so I looked at the lady and I said, "Ma'am, excuse me." She looked at me. I said, "You're having problems on the left side of your body, this numbness and this pain." And she goes, "I'm having problems on the left side of my body. I'm having numbness and pain." My mom looks at me, she goes, "Is this a little awkward? This a little crazy?" And I said, "Ma'am, I believe if you let me pray for you that I believe God is going to heal you." And she's, "Okay, that's fine." So I get out of the car and I start walking up to her car. She said, "Now listen." And we're in the buckle of the Bible, but she goes, "Now listen, I've heard these stories about people laying hands on people and, you know, that you can transfer weird spirits and all this." I mean, she was kind of getting into it. I said, "Listen, I'm not going to touch you. I'm not going to do anything. Let me just put my hands in my pocket. I'll step away from the car, and I'm just going to ask for the Holy Spirit to come and touch you. Is that okay?" And she said, "Okay." So I said, "Holy Spirit, let your presence come upon her." All of a sudden, she feels this tingling and this warmth come all over her body. And I said, "Why don't you try to do something you couldn't do before?" So she starts moving her arms. I couldn't do that. I said, "Well, how about your legs?" She goes, "There's still pain." So at a scale of 1 to 10, tell me the worst. She goes, "She's about a 9. I said, "Holy Spirit, come. I command all the pain, all the numbness to go." And she goes, "Man, I feel something." I said, "You want to try to do something you couldn't do?" She goes, "Yeah." So she gets out of the car and she starts walking. And I'm thinking, well, I mean, everybody walks, no big deal. And she goes, "Man, I couldn't do that." And she's like just really having this emotional response. And I said, what do you mean you couldn't do it? She goes, I could barely walk to the car. She goes, I drove up to the pharmacist and I had to send my sister in to get the prescription because I couldn't walk. And I was like, that's amazing. And so she ends up going in and walking into the store to meet her sister. And her sister comes out. She goes, what is going on? What was beautiful about the story as well, too, my mom goes in to get her prescription, and she overhears the lady I had just prayed for trying to get her, her sister was trying to get fill the medication from the pharmacist, and the pharmacist, for whatever reason, denied her prescription. So the lady would have pulled up to the pharmacist, trying to think that she was going to get relief from the pain medication that she needed, all to find out she couldn't get it.
Nothing. Yeah.
And here, God in breaks on behalf of this woman through just a simple, God speaking, and I had to take a risk. Is this the Lord? Is this my imagination? What? And so I just said, I'm just going to go for it and risk it. So the lady gets totally healed. Her sister comes out, sees this. She's like dumbfounded. And I could see that she was kind of a little bit puzzled, and that she was like, what about me? I said, well, hey, are you having any problems? Do you have any pain going on in your body? And she said, yeah, I have I have rheumatoid arthritis. I have all these conditions in my body. I'm just a lot of pain. I can't bend my knees. And I said, on a scale of 1 to 10, tell me the worst. She said, I think about 8 or 9. I said, okay, great. We're going to pray for you. I said, Mom, come here. My mom had never prayed for the sick. My mom was a little bit nervous. She was like, me? I said, yeah, come here, Mom. So just put your hand on her shoulder, and I just want you just to pray this. And, you know, it was really cute. She just, real quiet, you know, closes her eyes, and she's like, Holy Spirit, come. You know, touch her body, let all the pain go. Man, this, all of a sudden, the power of God just comes over this lady. And she starts bending, moving. I mean, tears coming down, completely gets healed.
Yeah.
And so that's a fascinating, fun story for me for a couple of reasons. One, we were just going about our day.
Yeah.
I was serving my mom. The Lord speaks to me in this place of, through a word of knowledge, you know, that the kingdom of God was at hand, even at, you know, Walgreens. My job was just to look, listen, and respond. And so I was listening in a supernatural way through the word of knowledge. And she gets healed. Now her sister comes out, and we were looking, listening, but not in a way of a word of knowledge, but just asking, is there something going on? She said, yeah, I have pain. Then here goes my mom praying for her, and the lady just totally gets crazy healed right there.
Wow, that's awesome.
So that was a fun, that's one story that's really fun. Another fun one was, it was about 10 o'clock at night, and I was driving home, and I called a buddy of mine, David, and he was in Atlanta, Georgia, and I keep hearing this beep, beep, beep. I said, David, where are you at? The supermarket? He says, yeah, I'm at Walmart. I said, that's pretty crazy. I said, it's kind of late to be at Walmart. He said, yeah. He said, I got to pick up just some extra stuff. And all of a sudden, I see this picture of a black woman about 5 feet tall. And I said, David, is there a black woman about 5 feet tall standing in front of you? He goes, Brian, there's a black woman about 5 feet tall standing in front of me right in front of the register. He said, what is the Lord saying to you? I was like, do you mean there's a black woman about 5 feet tall standing in front of you? You're not kidding me. He said, yeah. What is God saying to you? I'm like, at this point, I'm like dumbfounded. I'm like, this really is happening now. I'm really in this moment. And all of a sudden, I felt this shooting pain down my left hip going down to my leg. And I said, I think she's having problems in her lower back, sciatic nerve going into her leg. He goes, great, I'm going to tell her. I said, okay, you know, hey, what do I have to lose? I'm in Oklahoma driving, you know, you're the one that's going to get pounded if it's not. And so he says, excuse me, ma'am, I want to just share something with you. As soon as he does that, all this crazy commotion starts happening. I mean, she starts going off. There's this yelling match, and then I hear this guy's voice, and it's like bizarre. Then the phone goes like dead, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, I just got my friend killed. He thinks I'm hearing from God. He tells a woman that, you know, something's going on, and then the phone goes dead. So I call back up, and David's like, no, ma'am, I'm not trying to argue with you. I'm not trying to. She goes, you're not going to ruin my high tonight. He goes, I'm not trying to ruin your high. He said, I'm just trying to, I was going about my day, and I was talking to my buddy on the phone. He starts describing you in detail because the Lord starts speaking. He's like, what? And he said, there's a black one about 5 feet tall. You're about 5 feet tall. And she goes, yeah. And there's problems with your back. And her boyfriend said, there ain't no problem with her back. She gets completely quiet. She goes, let me talk to him. Hands her the phone, gets on the phone. I said, ma'am, I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to mess up your evening. I said, you know, I'm just, just a guy from Oklahoma, and I was talking to my buddy, and all of a sudden the Lord begins to speak to me and shows me a picture of, I guess, you. And there's a condition going on in your back, and I believe the Lord wants to heal you. And she goes, I'm not going to lie to you. I was a preacher's daughter, and she's been going through a lot of horrible stuff. You tell me why God took my husband and why he left me with 7 kids. And she starts going hysterical on the phone. I mean, she starts weeping, crying. Mm. I said, ma'am, I don't know. And I'm thinking at this point, since God gave me this picture, this revelatory realm is going to open up. I'm going to start telling her all this stuff about her life and giving her this great wisdom. The only thing I hear is the Lord tell her that I haven't forsaken her, that I love her, and she's not forgotten. So I tell her that, and she just loses it. Just, I mean, weeping uncontrollably. I pray for her, presence of God comes on her, and by this point, her boyfriend gets so frustrated, he takes all the groceries and just leaves, and the lady behind the counter, I can hear this, is going, hey, wait, sir, you haven't paid for that yet. So all this commotion's happening right there at Walmart, and I get off the phone with her. My buddy David ends up praying with her, talking a little bit more about what's going on. This lady keeps calling the next 2 or 3 days saying, I cannot believe it. I can't believe that God really came for me, that he didn't forget me. She goes, I was about ready that evening. They'd bought a whole bunch of beer, and she said she was going to, they had bought some other things. We're going to have a nice party. She was going to have just a little sexual encounter with her boyfriend, and she was going to end her life. Mm. And here God intervenes.
Wow.
Just talking to my buddy on the phone.
Wow.
And I just simply just said, hey, there's a black woman about 5 feet tall sitting in front of you. So that was kind of a wild encounter that happened through a word of knowledge.
Wow. Wow, wow, wow. So, yeah, and tell us about some crazy healings you've seen. Some great word of knowledge stories.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, gosh. There's been a lot of cool healings that have happened. I'll tell you one that was... This was also with a word of knowledge. This was a little bit of a risk and a part two where I saw a lot of actually defeat in the first part of the story. So this is a good one.
That's good, yeah.
So a buddy of mine named Greg and a guy named Ramey went out to Ada, Oklahoma, which was a kind of a rural area. And our purpose was just to kind of go practice power evangelism that day. And so we get there, we get to Greg's house, and we're praying, and we're just, you know, asking the Lord just to kind of soaking a little bit, praying, maybe more stalling. And so anyway, as we're praying, all of a sudden I have this urge to open Greg's door and yell out, there's a shaking of awakening coming to Ada, Oklahoma. And so I open the door and I yell this out right straight across the street to this door. And Greg goes, dude, I have to live here, man. Please don't do that. And I'm thinking, well, I don't have to live here, you know, so what's the big deal? And so we're going around, we're praying a little bit more, and then I think we're still kind of stalling. These guys were a little bit nervous. I was nervous too, but they were probably a little bit more nervous about going out. And so we're praying, and as we're praying, I had this bizarre picture that came. And the picture that I saw was these two little kids in diapers jumping and splashing and around in oil. And I'm thinking, this is the weirdest picture. What do I do with this? I mean, we're fixing to go out and do, you know, power evangelism stuff. And so I share that, and we're like, we don't know what to do with it. So we're still walking, kind of praying, kind of stalling a little bit. And I see this lady, where I had just yelled out this, there's a shaking of awakening. And this guy, they're in a car, and they're parked like right in the street. And as soon as I look out the window, I see this lady, and all of a sudden I get these impressions just start flooding my mind about these conditions that are going on in her body. And I knew that she was anemic. I knew that she'd had all this crazy stuff that was going on in her life. And there was like, I can't remember all 7 of them. The last one was, and she loves horses. I was like, kind of, and she loves horses. And so I thought, okay, I mean, this is an opportunity. I'll just go out there and figure out how I'm going to approach her and say, hey, this is what I feel God's saying. But nature called. I had to go to the bathroom, like, super bad. And so I ran to the restroom, and I thought, you know, I'll go to the bathroom, and as soon as I get out, you know, she'll still be there. Well, I really had to go to the restroom. So I came out, and she wasn't there. And so I told the guys about it, and I was like, I said, Greg, do you know this lady? Does she live across the street? I looked across the street. There was no one there. There's no cars now. I was like, I went out, looked down the road to see if they parked somewhere else. Couldn't find them. I thought, well, maybe I just missed it. Whatever. So after we kind of got through stalling, we decided, okay, let's just go to a safe place. Let's go to like a coffee shop and we'll try to do this stuff. So we go to the coffee shop, we get there, and both my buddies were a little bit nervous about trying this out. So of course I had to go ahead and go forward. So I went up and to the lady, the barista, and I said, hey, listen, this is all going on in your life, and start telling her all this stuff. And there was another couple that was in the coffee shop with us. And I started telling all this stuff, blah, blah, blah. And I said, does this make any sense? She goes, nope. And I hear these people laughing and heckling me at the same time. And I said, none of that makes sense to you. She goes, nope. I said, I'm pretty bad at this, aren't I? She goes, yeah, you're really bad at this. I'm like, oh my gosh, my friends are back there and they're like, just glad that they didn't go first. And I was like, oh man. So we left the coffee shop, and I said, all right, man, let's just go door to door. Let's just go knocking door to door. So we went knocking door to door and these apartment complexes, and most people weren't home. Finally, we get to a couple of places. People are slamming the door in their face. Finally, this guy lets us pray for him. So we started to pray for him. And at the end, he basically tells me how bad my prophetic ministry is. Now, it's a horrible day when the loss tells you how bad your prophetic ministry is.
Oh, wow.
And so I feel like a dog with my tail between my legs. I said, let's just go. This stuff just doesn't work. So we're on our way. And one of the things that my buddy Ramey actually had gotten earlier that day was that we were going to find someone that had a problem with, I think, the right shoulder. We never found the guy with the right shoulder, at least when we were out. So we were going home and just kind of shaking our head, just going, well, we tried, I guess, trying to give us that pep talk. At least we went out.
Yeah, right.
So we get back to his house, and as soon as we walk in the house, Chris, his wife, goes, I'm so sorry for the smell in here. I'm so sorry. We're like, man, it didn't smell bad. I mean, I have like 8 kids. I mean, I've had diapers everywhere, so I'm thinking it didn't smell bad at all in here. And she goes, I'm so sorry. She goes, I got home with the kids, put them down, and we had some groceries, and I actually fell asleep, and I wake up, and I find the girls in diapers, and they got into the potpourri oil, broke it all over the floor, and were jumping and playing in the oil. I look at Greg, I look at Ramey, we go, our mouth drops, like, what? This is nuts. Like, this is what I saw.
Right.
And so this faith kind of hit me. It was this whole idea is like, here we were, like, little kids, we'd our dirty diapers on the whole bit. I mean, just messing it up everywhere we went. And I feel the Lord said, I'm going to show you how to play in the oil. I look across the street, and where I had said that there's a shaking of awakening coming to Ada, all these guys were congregated in the front yard. And so I said, let's go across there. Now, Greg was like, man, this is a known drug house. I don't know if we want to go there. I said, let's do it, man. Come on. So we walk over there, and now this boldness just hit me because of just this encounter, this simple thing of what I'd seen. And so I said, listen, I said, there was a lady that was over here around this part of time of the day. He said, yeah. I said, is she here right now? And this guy was on the phone. There's a lot of guys standing around. And he was kind of like listening to me, but not listening to me. I said, no, listen, there was a lady, described her. And he goes, yeah, she was here. Why? What do you want with her? I said, listen, I'm a neighbor friend, and I saw her earlier, and I feel like I have a message from the Lord for her. Could you get her on the phone? He was like, he's talking to this guy. He said, I gotta let you go. Some neighbors over here told me he has a message from the Lord from one of our friends. Hangs it. Now, what are you talking about? So I tell him the whole thing. He said, all right. So he calls with the girl, said, listen, this is the craziest thing. There's this neighbor guy that comes across the street and said he has a message from God for you. And he hands me the phone. And I said, listen, I said, I know this sounds absolutely crazy, but I saw you earlier. You were here about this time. She said, yeah. I said, now I'm going to tell you these 7 things, and if none of them are true, you just tell me. And so I start just naming off. All of a sudden, I start hearing her just start weeping over the phone. And I said, you're anemic. You've had all this abuse in your life, all this stuff. I said, this is true. She goes, it's true. It's true. It's true. I said, oh, by the way, you love horses. And she goes, oh my gosh, it's true. I said, can you come over here so we can pray for you? And but this time the guy, he could hear her crying and weeping over the phone. He hears what I'm saying to her. He's just kind of looking around. This is bizarre. All these guys are standing around looking. And she goes, well, I don't know. I'm supposed to get my boyfriend on a bus to go to another part of town so he can go to work. But maybe we can come by right before we take him to the bus. I said, man, come over here. We want to pray for you. So we get off the phone with her, and the guy's just looking at me like, this is bizarre. I said, listen, I just told him exactly what I said to the lady. And I said, as she's coming right here so we can pray for her. I said, is there anybody here that needs anything that we can pray for? The guy goes, man, this is so weird that you're coming over here right now. I said, why is that? He said, well, he said, I just had a buddy that just overdosed about a week ago from drugs, and we all just got back from a funeral, and that's why they were there.
Mm.
And I said, well, is there anything that I could pray for you about? He said, man, he said, I have a really bad eye problem. I'm losing my sight. I can only see about right here. I said, well, let me pray for you. And so we start to pray for him. And I think I prayed for him about 3 or 4 times. And every single time, his sight begins to increase.
Hmm.
I step away about 3 feet. He can see. He's, I can see. Halfway down the block, man, his eye completely opens up. He's flipped out. This other guy, I'm like, so, hey, can we pray for you? People are jumping in their car and like leaving. They're freaked out, right? But this guy's like dumbfounded. About that time, the lady that I talked to on the phone pulls up. She gets out of the car, and I said, in front of everybody that was still left, I said, listen, I said, you had these 7 things. I start just telling her all the 7 things, and she's like just weeping. She goes, yes, yes. So I start praying for her. Well, I told you about the guy, my friend, that said he had the problem with the right shoulder.
Yeah.
Well, it was her boyfriend. Mm. He had a right problem with his right shoulder. And so after I prayed for her, we went over to pray for him. No, this would only happen in Ada, Oklahoma. And we prayed for my son. On a scale of 1 to 10, to me, the worst word is about a 10. I mean, he could move it to about right here. And mind you, he was fixing to go out to work, and he didn't know how he was going to do it.
Mm.
Dude, his arm, he's moving his arm, doing all this kind of stuff, but he was wondering about the strength in his arm. I said, well, you want to pick up something, you know, that you can see how strong it is? And so this is what he does. He said, honey, let me see the baby. He takes the baby, one hand, and goes, I couldn't do that before. And we're all just sitting there going, this is bizarre. You don't do that with your baby.
Yeah, right.
But this is Ada, Oklahoma. And so anyway, so this happens. I mean, they're like undone. I mean, he gets healed. She gets touched. And she's like, oh my gosh, we're going to get to our bus, or you're not going to get to work. I mean, they're just weeping, crying. We share the gospel with them. They leave. The guy's eye, you know, been opened. He's just like flipping out. And I see this one guy, and he's sitting on the steps. And he's just like really just like dumbfounded about what's going on. He's like, but he's scared. Mm. I said, all of a sudden, this authority comes on me. I said, hey, you, come here. And he walks over to me. And I said, listen, what can we pray for about in your life?
Mm.
And he begins to open. He said, I've been having this addiction in my life, and I really want it to be broken. So we start to pray for him, and man, the presence of the Lord just starts coming all on him. My buddy Greg is with us, and he says, you know, I believe God just is really going to unlock your heart. He has a key for you. And Greg just kind of is, you know, look at the ground, and he's kind of kicking at the ground, and he goes, yeah, God just really has a key for you. And he looks down, and he sees a shiny thing, and I'm looking down at Greg's foot, because I'm like, why is he looking at the ground? Greg bends down and says, it's kind of like a key like this. And pulls out a key, and it's like a treasure chest key. The guy's eyes bug out, mouth dropped, my mouth dropped. I go, what the heck, where was that? This is what the guy said. He goes, this has to be God, this has to be God. I said, what do you mean? He said, I collect hundreds of keys like this. Guy totally flips out.
Wow.
Share the gospel with him. He's flipping out, I mean, shaking the power. And so, man, about this time, Greg's brother just pulls up, and he gets out, and he's like, he said, dude, it's like the shift of an atmosphere. He's like, what happened here? He didn't know what we were doing evangelism. So he goes, what is going on? He was like, something just changed in the atmosphere. So we're leaving. We walk away, and we're just kind of shaking our head going, this is amazing. I mean, this is how you do evangelism in the power of the Holy Spirit, right?
Yeah, right.
You know, we missed it all that day. And the beauty of the story is that sometimes we're going to go out, and we're going to fail. We're going to miss it.
Mm.
But what about risking it? Just keep going. And the Lord has something. Funny story is that Greg goes back the next day to see how, do a kind of a follow-up. Knocks on the door. This lady answers the door. Not the same lady we prayed for, a different lady. She goes, are you the guys that came over here and prayed for all these guys yesterday? He said, yes. Man, you flipped them out. He's like, what do you mean? the guy just kept saying, he came back in the house, he was shaking, he goes, I feel like I've been tasered. I feel like you've been tasered. I was like, so now I know what the Holy Spirit feels like, I guess. It feels like you're getting tasered, you know?
Right.
So that was a pretty wild encounter, you know, blind eye opens, wow. Shoulder gets healed, crazy, you know, word of knowledge happening. So, but a lot of failure at the beginning point of that. Mm. You know, people telling us how bad our prophetic ministry was.
Right.
From
right.
a loss, you know?
Yeah. But you push through. Wow.
We push through.
Tell me a little bit about process. Yeah. Like, do you see more now than you used to? And how did that kind of, if so, like, how did that develop? How did that open?
I do now, because in the beginning, like I said, I didn't know what I was doing. I just would get these things and I would respond. When I found out that you could be intentional with stuff, we've been commissioned to go, that no matter what, you know, where you're going, whether that's to Walmart, whether that's to the grocery store, whether that's to work, that we have been given this message, the kingdom of God is at hand. And so as I begin to see that, and it didn't have to happen through a word of knowledge, that you could just see somebody and see a need. Like, case in point, I'll tell you a story. We were at a hotel, I was with my family, and I see this gentleman, and he was, I saw him walking with a limp. So I didn't get any word of knowledge. I just saw a guy walking with a limp. And so this is how I was looking, listening, and responding. I see a need. A guy has a problem with his knee. So I went in and approached him. I said, hey, what's going on with your knee? He said, oh man. He said, he's about 65 years old. He worked there at the hotel. His name was Robert. And he said, I have this poor, you know, knee problem. I had arthritic condition. I've had it for a long time. And I said, really? I said, on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the worst, what's your pain level? He didn't know what I was doing. I began to interview him, find out what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, I'd say probably, you know, close to 8, 9 level pain. I said, man, that's pretty bad. I said, hey, listen, do you mind if I just pray for you? I like to just serve people in practical ways by praying for physical needs. And he was kind of like taken back by that for a moment. He's like, okay, sure. Now, I think he thought I was going to pray for him later.
Right.
And so what I did is I just stepped back and I said, Holy Spirit, would you just come right now? And I just released healing on his knee. In Jesus' name, he's like, oh, thank you, young man. But the third step he takes, all of a sudden he begins to go, whoa, and like gyrate through his entire body. He looks back at me, I look at him. He walks another foot or two, and then he goes, whoa, gyrates again. And he literally walks clear across about every, I'd say 3 or 4 feet, this thing happens where he just gyrates through his body. He walks clear across the lobby and back, doing the same thing. And he walks to me and goes, young man, I have to tell you something. I go, what's that? He said, I think your prayer worked. About that time, my little boy, Tyler, comes up to me and said, Daddy, I gotta go to the bathroom. I gotta go to the bathroom really, really bad. I was like, okay, I'm sorry. Sorry, sir, I gotta take my son to the bathroom. So take him to the bathroom. We're there in the hotel, and I see a guy walk in, and he has a white shirt. Looked like he was like a kitchen staff guy. So he walks in, and we're there at the urinal, go to the bathroom. We just strike up a conversation, start talking to him. And, he just happens to mention about, I said, hey, we just were talking, and he goes, man, yeah, I hope the weather changes. He said, because my birthday is like tomorrow, and he said, I want to be out and barbecuing and the whole thing. And I said, yeah, that's awesome. He said, man, I hope I feel better too. He said, I just, man, I feel like I'm, you know, my body's breaking down. I said, how old are you? He said, I'm 44. I said, man, you look a whole lot younger than, not that 44 is old, but he felt like he was just all crippled. I said, what's going on? He said, well, it's old football injury. And neck problems, back problems. I was like, really? I got my curiosity. I thought, okay. So got done, you know, used the restroom, washed your hands. And I said, hey, listen, you work here at the hotel? He said, yeah. I said, you know a guy named Robert? And he said, yeah, I know Robert. He's, you know, 65-year-old man. He, you know, he walks with a limp. I said, does that ring a bell to you? He said, yeah, I know who you're talking about. I said, well, he doesn't walk with a limp anymore. He said, what? What are you talking about? Mm. I said, well, right before I came in the restroom, we prayed for him, and Jesus totally healed him. Now, you told me you have neck and back problems. I said, you mind if I pray for you right now? And I believe all the pain's going to leave.
Mm.
He's like, why not? So I have my son, who's about 9 years old. I said, hey, Tyler, let's pray for him. So we pray for him right there in the bathroom. The guy totally gets healed, neck, back, brain, just totally healed. And so that was not, you know, through, you know, a word of knowledge. It was just me simply hearing him have a condition.
Mm.
And so I think oftentimes we can, if we're just focused on, you know, hearing through a word of knowledge, then we'll see a lot happen, but we'll miss a lot too. Mm. We need to be able to see that God is actively working all the time and that we can join him by just seeing a need. Mm. And so as I begin to see that, and then knowing that I could intentionally go out to do ministry, that's where I begin to see a major increase. Because before, I was just waiting when I got like a word of knowledge, if that makes sense.
Okay. Yeah. So yeah. You'd move if you heard God say something. If I heard, kind of opening the door yourself.
Yeah. And so now it's like I'm looking always for conditions. I'm looking, you know, in the natural, and I'm also hearing. That's why it's that look, listen, you know, respond type thing. Another cool story that happened in the same hotel the next day. I'm there, and lady comes to clean our room, and my kids were going to stay back. And so I was opening the door, the cleaning lady's there, and she said, I'm here to clean your room. And I said, no, don't worry about cleaning my room, because my kids are going to stay, and you can come back later. And at this point, the Lord, right when I was talking to her, I felt this sensation go down my back, and knew that she had back problems. I said, hey, you're having a back problem, back pain. She goes, how did you know that? I said, well, you know, I really didn't know. I said, but Jesus knows, and he loves you. And I said, do you mind if I just take a moment just to pray for you? And she's like, okay. She puts out her hands, and I grab her hands and start praying for her, and ask the Holy Spirit to come. And all of a sudden, she starts going like this. I mean, just wobbling and shaking. And about that time, my buddy, Kelly, came around the corner on the 7th floor, and he sees this happen. He's going, dude, this is crazy. This lady's just like shaking like this. All of a sudden, I mean, she just, power of God hits her. She starts to fall. Kelly runs and catches the lady. She falls on the ground, and then there she's shaking for about 10 minutes, just gyrating on the floor. And it literally looked like she was being, like on a chiropractic table being reworked. Mm. Well, the funny thing about it was, too, is people were open. They were hearing this commotion, so they were opening their room door, looking down the hallway, looking at the lady, looking at us, going, you know, shut the door, like freaking out. My kids open the door, look at me, oh, daddy's just praying for somebody, you know, shuts the door. So we sit there, we just love on this lady, prophesy over, and she's just, I mean, gyrating, power of God's on her. Finally, we get up, and I said, what happened to you? You know, I was curious by that point. Mm. She goes, I didn't know how I was going to do it. I go, what do you mean? You know how you're going to do what? She goes, I didn't know how I was going to clean my 70 rooms today. Mm. She goes, I've been pain for over a year and a half. And today it was so bad. It was like about a 10 level pain. All the pain completely left. It was just amazing. Mm. Just so the kingdom of God is at hand no matter what, no matter where we are. Mm. And our job is just to look, listen, respond, whether that's in a natural setting of seeing something happen or hearing from the Lord.
Yeah. Do you have any like sort of keys that the Lord has taught you in terms of like, you know, you move powerfully in word of knowledge. You see a lot of healing, like that has helped you sort of progress further into words of knowledge, further into healing. You know, like we all go through process. You know, we see more gradually, and the Lord teaches us lessons kind of in that. Do you have any keys to share there?
The biggest insight I believe for the word of knowledge is this: is to go with the first impression. Second is to when I heard John, I think John Wimber said this. It was either John Wimber or Blaine Cook. He said that words of knowledge are like fleeting thoughts that they just learn how to grab a hold of. Mm. And to me, that's when I started to really excel in the word of knowledge. In the beginning, what happened was I would feel like the sympathy pain is really, really strong. And in certain situations, I'd feel that. I'd feel it, or I'd see a picture, you know, or I would just sometimes just say it like that. That's how most commonly they come to me. In the beginning, it was really strong, kind of, I think, to help kind of boost my faith, get my attention. But then when I began just to kind of give myself more to that, I just began to just to have those fleeting thoughts and grab a hold of them and try. Mm. That's when I started seeing a whole lot more happen with that. And, you know, crazy thing, I think just learning how to practice the presence of the Lord in that. And there's always risk in it. One time I was, this has actually happened a couple different times. Kind of a bizarre situation that happened. I had sat down. It was kind of a long day, hard day, and went and sat in my office, and actually just was sitting there, and just in my shirt and my underwear, you know, had a glass of wine, was just kind of hanging out for the day, and just wanted to relax. And I remember a buddy of mine was going to have Steve Thompson on at his church and doing a live streaming, and so I thought I'd just, you know, sit back and just kind of watch what was going on and just kind of relax. And so I'm watching there's service, and I'm just kind of just relaxed for the day. And all of a sudden, these words of knowledge start coming to me. Now, I'm watching over the internet.
Mm.
And I'm going, this can't be happening. This is bizarre. And so I thought, okay, is this the Lord or is this me? So I decided, okay, I'm going to text my buddy Ryan. I could see the back of his head, you know, through the streaming video. So I had about 15, 20 words of knowledge just came.
Wow.
Some were really specific. So I text them to him. And next thing I know is he gets up and he said, and this is kind of bizarre. He said, a buddy of mine's watching live streaming. And here's a number of the words that he had. And then their streaming thing just went down, so I didn't get to see what was going on. And because Steve Thompson was preaching, he said, I don't think we're going to do ministry tonight. And then my buddy Ryan comes up and he shares these words. And so I didn't get to see what happened. So I thought, man, maybe I missed it. I don't know. About 20 minutes later, Ryan calls me and said, dude, that was crazy amazing. Give these words, and like healing started busting out everywhere, all over the place.
Mm.
Like just healings popping. And so I was like, Lord, this is crazy. I mean, just at home, the kingdom of God is at home. Even when you're at home relaxing, you know, God is at work. And so I thought, man, that can only happen one time. Well, it was bizarre. That was 2 years ago, but just a few months ago, Steve Thompson was back at their church, and I sat back to watch the streaming again, and I'm sitting there, I'm just remembering, you know, what had happened. Same thing starts happening again. Words of knowledge just start pouring in. And so I text Ryan, and I said, hey, Ryan, wave at the camera. I can see you. And he's like laughing. I said, hey, by the way, I have some words of knowledge I share with him. And he's like, this is crazy. He gets up. Now this time I see him. So it's like, he said, this happened like 2 years ago. My buddy Brian was watching, you know, live streaming, and he shares these words, and people start standing up everywhere. Bam, 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 getting healed. Just crazy, wild thing.
Wow.
But most of those, again, were not these crazy, like loud booming, you know, sensations or they're mainly just thoughts.
Right.
That I just started writing down, then I risked it.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
And when did you, I love kind of in your stories, because you kind of learn to capture that word of knowledge confidently enough where you're just kind of like, hey, you've got something wrong with your back or whatever. You know, so how did that work? I mean, when did you get so confident that you were like, yeah, I know this is God, you know, and I'm not going to kind of beat around the bush. I'm just going to know that this is right and just kind of go for it.
Yeah, you know, when we teach people that, we often tell them, you know, use it in the form of a question, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's a really safe place to do it, and it can be an honoring place. But there also is a time that when the Lord gives that, there's a faith that's there.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think for those men that have been probably doing it for a while, again, at the beginning, I tell people, just ask it the form of question. And I still do that and play that.
Right.
But there's
right.
times that, I mean, just because the Lord's just come, it's like, are you going to risk it? And I have found when I have shared a word of knowledge like that, more instant healings happen that way.
Oh, interesting.
Then from the place of just saying, hey, do you kind of have this? And it's kind of this unsure place.
Mm.
But if I tell them what's going on in their body, they're like, you could not have known that. And then it's like immediately something just happens.
Mm.
And so, and I've been wrong in that too. And
sure.
You just kind of have to backpedal. And so I just tell them, why are you asking that? Well, I'm a Mormon, you know, I'm not joking with them. And I played off. I said, well, I just was wondering, you know, what was going on. And I just kind of, you know, don't make a big deal of it. And usually they don't either. And so, but I just started with that. And I saw an increase of the immediate release of healing when I was doing that.
Mm, mm.
So that's one of the reasons why I do that.
Yeah, so that's almost kind of like a key to healing, I guess, in that God
showing
you. Yeah,
it really, it opens the door right
interesting.
There and just unlocks something.
That's really interesting.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Tell us about like models. Like, I think it's really interesting, you know, your story, you sort of bumped into all of this and sort of journeyed your own trail, you know, you weren't really kind of following anyone with this. And so I think that's really unique because you learn unique things, you develop your own unique model. So you know, what's your model for power evangelism? How do you activate people and teach people to go for it?
Go for it. Well, the first thing is what we do is we just empower people by saying that the kingdom of God's at hand. I mean, we give them that message. I know I go back to that, but that's really where it is, because it is that there was a central thing of what Jesus proclaimed, the gospel of the kingdom, that we're all commissioned to do it, and giving people permission, basically, that you can do this. And so that's a big thing. So we'll take, like I said, we take teams out, you know, all those kind of things. And then, you know, basically I took that five-step model of Wimber's, the interview and diagnostic decision, prayer selection, all that kind of stuff. And I kind of broke it down this way for power evangelism. I said, you know, the first thing is the approach. I mean, how do you approach someone? That's usually the hard part, right? Mm. It's, you know, how, if I have a word of knowledge, you know, how am I going to say that to them? Sometimes it is coming to them, hey, you have this condition, blah, 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 or it's whatever. So I try to figure out how I'm going to approach someone. And I always approach people in this way. I approach them with absolute faith in my heart that I know that Jesus is, wants to come to touch them. I've been commissioned to go. Mm. Honoring the person, loving the person, you know. I'm eagerly desiring more spiritual gifts in that process. Mm. You know, following the way of love, eagerly desiring spiritual gifts. And I'm approaching them with a smile. I'm approaching them friendly. Mm. And I'm walking to someone and I'm saying, hey, do you mind if I just share something with you a little bit, maybe out of the ordinary? Or sometimes I see pictures and impressions and I got this picture, you mind if I share it with you? Or I'll say, hey, can I just serve you in a real practical way by praying for anything that you might have? Mm. Another approach is, when we teach a lot of people to do this, and I've done this, it actually works, kind of funny, is I'll say, hey, we've been in a class learning how to hear God's voice outside the four walls of the church. I know it sounds really crazy, but I have a homework assignment and I really need somebody's help. I need a guinea pig. You might be my guinea pig. Mm. And I've had more people say, yeah, you can go for it. And so we've done that. So just trying to figure out, you can be creative in the process. Mm. Whatever works comfortable for you. So it's the approach. And you really want to make the person feel as comfortable as possible. The approach, then I ask, what's going on? And where I began to see a greater release in healing was through on the scale of 1 to 10. Mm-hmm. That really helped me. So if you're at a 10 level, and I start praying for you, you know, as I begin to, if you told me your shoulder was, your right shoulder was at a 10 level pain, then I would begin to pray, ask the Holy Spirit to come, or I'd speak to the condition, I command it to go. And that was another key too, is not petitioning, but speaking with authority and power to the condition,
right? Mm-hmm.
And telling it to go. And here's the other thing too, is when we're in church, we got lots of time to pray for somebody. Mm. We're out in the streets, you got maybe 15, 30 seconds.
Yeah.
And so we have to have short, effective prayers. And so, you know, I'd speak to the condition, I'd command the shoulder to go, and I'd say, okay, you said it was about a 10, what would you say it's now? They go, wow, I feel this, you know, I feel heat, I feel warm. I'd say it's probably like maybe a 5. I said, if it can go from a 10 to a 5, you think it can go from a 5 to a 0? They're like, I don't know, maybe. And we just kind of work them the process down. I've seen it go from, you know, 5 to 4 to 3 to 2 to 1 to a 0.
Sure.
You know, that way. Or sometimes it just jumps completely like that. And so that's one of the things we do in the asking stage, asking what's going on. And then we move again, you know, into the prayer. So it's approach, ask, pray, and then I ask again. How are we doing? Finding out what's going on in their body. And the final thing is really explain. So do you know what just happened to you? Like, no, what? So this is the love of God. Mm. God has come near you because he loves you. What you're feeling is the presence of the Lord. And they're shocked usually. Mm. And I say, hey, you know, when you go home tonight, you can just sit in your room and put out your hands and just say, Holy Spirit, come. You know what? He'll come. And so I kind of give them language like that. And then oftentimes people start saying, well, why are you doing this? What church are you? What are you trying to sell? You know, that kind of thing. I said, I'm not trying to sell you anything. I'm not trying to get you to do anything. I'm just wanting to let you know that God loves you. He's madly in love. He's pursuing you. Mm. And just try to explain it that way. And there are times that we do follow it up when someone is the invitation to come into, you know, a relationship with Jesus as well.
Sure, sure. I really like that last step, that kind of explain step. Do you find that without that, people go away confused?
Absolutely. That's why we do that, is explain, because to help them to understand what is that. Because most people are just like dumbfounded. They'll sit there and just like shocked, you know. Mm. Or if you don't ask them what's going on or explain what's going on, I mean, the asking and the explanation, I think, are the two keys. Because sometimes you'll say, well, I feel something. They don't know what's going on. So I mostly don't ask them, are you feeling a heat? Are you feeling a tingling? I want them to tell me that. Mm-hmm. So I'll say, what do you expect? Well, it's kind of like electricity, or it's kind of like fire. I was like, well, what does that mean? Is that good? Is that bad? Mm. You know, we talk about that. And then, again, I go back to the explanation of saying, this is what's happening to you, to give them context, mm. to be able to, you know, walk away with, wow, the God of the universe just encountered you. You know?
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's really good. Would you say power evangelism is for every church?
100% yes.
100% yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And would you say it's for every believer?
100% yes.
Okay, cool. So yeah. How do you see that fitting with different, you know, personalities and different gift mixes then?
Yeah, here's the thing. I think sometimes we've chalked up to evangelists or power evangelists, like type A personalities. These are they're the Green Berets, you know, of the kingdom, man. They're going to go take everything. And I, there's truth to that. There's people that are like that. But I like to paint a different picture. I think power evangelists could be soccer moms.
Mm-hmm.
You know, business women, businessmen, dads, kids. And so when we start to categorize someone in a specific, you know, personality type, then what we do is we start to say these guys can really play, but the rest of us can't. You have to be a certain way.
Right.
And I think that's why it's also really important that we let people, you know, we don't need to try to be, whoever's the hot evangelist or whoever's the hot, you know, whatever personality type. That's not where, be you. And God wants to operate through your personality. And so however that is, I mean, it could be from you just sitting, you know, at a coffee shop and the Lord just whispers something, you strike up a conversation with somebody. And then out of that, you start talking. So I say, just do it in a way that it feels most comfortable to you, but also risk. Push the bounds. And sometimes, like I said, it doesn't matter if it's the deep end or the shallow end, it's just getting in the pool. And sometimes when people get into the shallow end, they're thinking, man, I like the deep end. I want to try some different stuff. And some people get in the deep end going, you know what? I think I want to hang out on the shallow end. It's okay. Don't make it some big thing. I have to, if to be a power evangelist, I have to look like so-and-so. I have to have this personality or this type. Because then what happens, we shut it down in the church.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, that's good. That's good. Now, you mentioned, you know, that you think it's for business moms and business people and soccer moms and all that. And, you know, that brings up the fact that, you know, you are a businessman. You're not on staff at a church. Yeah. And I mean, you do train and equip and do some traveling. But I love that combination of everybody gets to play. You're just a normal dude.
Yeah.
So tell us about that. I mean, like, how do you feel that's affected your ministry? Do you think it actually gives you more credibility as an evangelist and just tell us about that decision.
Yeah, you know what? I think it does. I think what happens is people, when I come to do a training event or I come to speak, most people are thinking, oh, you know, he must be a traveling evangelist. He must be, you know, a pastor on the church. So when I say, hey, look, I'm a dad of six. You know, I have a wife. I have my own business. I'm not paid on staff anywhere. They're kind of like, I said, I'm just like you. And it's like light bulbs kind of go on. And I think it gives people permission to think, well, man, if that guy can do it, maybe I can do it. And I think it's probably maybe my greatest message is that. I'm just an average guy.
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
Do you think it gives you more credibility, like, on the streets and so forth as well? Or maybe it doesn't come up.
The streets didn't come up. No, yeah. they don't know. You know, and I have had people ask me, so are you a pastor or a preacher? I said, no, man, I'm just a Christian. Just loving Jesus, and he loves me. And he's encountered me, and so that's why.
Right.
That's it.
And I know, you know, there's a lot of people that, you know, it's like full-time ministry becomes a goal.
Yeah.
You know, occupationally. Yeah. You know, obviously we're all in full-time ministry, right? That's Christianity, but you know, occupationally, full-time ministry becomes a goal. And you know, how would you counsel those people? Because you're not in that place, and you're saying it makes you more fruitful. You think?
Yeah.
So I mean, what would you speak to those people?
Well, I think a couple things. One is that if we define everything to the kingdom message as being that everyone has to be a pastor, then we've eliminated 99% of the church. Do you know what I'm saying? I mean, that's just not going to happen. I do think God, you know, raises up, you know, pastors, prophets, teachers, you know, the fivefold ministry to equip the saints, to coach the saints, to, you know, to build them up and edify them. And, you know, there may be a time in my life where that becomes more of you know, I do that more in a place where I can give myself to that time. That may happen, I don't know. I do think that the church needs to get better at kind of pulling in that gift to the church. They're mm-hmm. not so good at that. It's usually just the pastor, the teacher. We haven't made so much room for the evangelist.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And that, what I mean by the evangelist of that is someone that can help to, you know, I think, you know, pastors pastor, they equip and make other pastors. You know, teachers teach and they, you know, produce other teachers. So that's what an evangelist's job is to do too. It's not just to be the only person doing it. It's to help to equip others or to pull that gifting out, right? And so I think it would be, I think if the church starts to see that more, and mm-hmm. makes room for that, I think they'll see a greater expansion of evangelism mm-hmm. if they make room for that office.
Okay.
So I think that's an important key factor. But, you know, that's what I love about the school that you're doing. You've made it for the 90%, people that can't just move somewhere, somebody that can't just, you know, pay thousands of dollars to do something. I mean, you're going after, your same goal is going after the businessmen, the soccer moms, the kids. I mean, just, so everybody can play.
Yeah.
And I think that's important, is that we get that message back. That's the rich heritage of, obviously, Jesus's message, but I mean, something unique too to what God gave the vineyard and what the vineyard really helped to release to the church. And so, and that's what excited me is when I saw that normal everyday people were being used in extraordinary ways, that's what won my heart.
So Brian, tell us about you know, the process of growing in the gift, you know, and especially as an everyday person.
Yeah.
You know, someone who can't go to dozens and dozens of conferences a year or whatever. You know, what does that look like? What's that process?
You know, the biggest process, or the biggest key, honestly, and it's going to be a very simple answer. It's, you just have to step out of the boat. It's like when Peter walked on water, he had to step out of the boat, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, so that's honestly, it's just saying, you know what, God, you've commissioned me. Matthew 10 says that you've commissioned me to go. You know, that the Spirit of the Lord really is on me, that this is Jesus' job description, yes, but he commissioned us with the same job description. And, you know, Jesus' ministry was going about, you know, destroying the works of the enemy. And as a disciple, that's what I'm to do. And so, you know, you're never going to move in the gift of healing, prophetic ministry, power evangelism, you know, seeing the presence without praying for somebody. And so it's okay to, you know, start out and, you know, pray in teams, you know, in small groups. You know, I mean, that's a great way to develop and to get an understanding, to exercise, you know, spiritual gifts. We do that a lot, doing, activations. To kind of get comfortable, that's a good place. But I've often found, I take people out for the first time, you know, and just say, hey, come watch me, and just kind of tag along.
Yeah.
You know, and then I'll kind of start all of the approach. That's usually the hardest part. And then I'll just say, hey, why don't you put your hand here, and then you just pray this. And I'm telling you, you can do that with someone that's never done it. I take my five-year-olds out all the time, and they see stuff happen. I'm thinking of a five-year-old can see the sick healed, you can do it.
Yeah.
You know, and they've seen some pretty dramatic, wild, you know, encounters, which is amazing to me. I think, gosh, I mean, growing up in that atmosphere, I'm just wondering what that's going to be like when they, they're seeing this as normal. You know, I mean, that wasn't normal to me. But, you know, so I think, you know, getting on your, if you don't have a healing ministry in the church, I mean, start one. You know, if you're wanting to grow in that, get around people that are doing it. Just start praying for people in the church, and then take a step out and say, hey, let me go to maybe mix it with servant evangelism. Find somebody else that's doing it. One of the ways that I grew too in the process was getting around people. Now, I couldn't get around, you know, certain people, Blaine Cook, I was just a happenstance. I got to go to a meeting and then happened, he called me out. But, you know, most of us aren't going to get to hang out with Bill Johnson, Randy Clark, Robbie Dawkins, Todd White, you know, any of these guys. But, you know, the great thing is that there's books, there's tapes, you know, Wimber. I mean, I'd watch all these videos. And so sometimes you get around a person that way and grow in the process of listening. I think a lot of it is it's more caught in that place than it is taught. And it comes out through just doing it. That's the only way that you're going to get activated. So you can't just like, okay, I'm going to get this all, you know, down and then I go do it. Mm. That's not going to happen. As I think Robbie says this, and I love this statement that he says. He said, if you make yourself available, God will put if you make yourself available, God will put his ability on your availability. Mm. I think he says something along those lines. And I love that. I think our job is just to make ourselves available. It's his job to put his ability on our availability. Mm. And so I think doing that, you know, but getting around people if you can at any stage of the game, and just kind of watching, just kind of be a fly on the wall maybe at first. Mm. And do that. That's one way. You know, reading, I think just renewing our mind, that, you know, open up the Gospels again, fresh and anew. Mm. I mean, how's that? I mean, look, yeah, how, right, Jesus did it. Look how the disciples did it. And you know what's funny is when you start to look at how the disciples, we think about, you know, man, wow, these powerful, because we think of Acts, right? We, yeah, forget about, man, Peter, I mean, denying Christ, I mean, him having faith at one moment and sinking, you know, then multiplying, you know, the bread, and then the next moment thinking, how are we going to do this? I mean, so it's pretty comical, you know, yeah, in that sense. And that kind of gives me hope, thinking, man, if these guys messed that up, they were with Jesus. Mm. I mean, they were with Emmanuel, God with us, walking with him. And they were seeing signs and wonders, and they were like, they didn't even know who he was. They didn't know how to do it still. I'm thinking, okay, that gives me grace. You know,
yeah,
what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And so I think that's just, also I think, listen, we don't have to perform. This is a big deal. Because if we know this, is that we don't bring ministry. Ministry is already happening. The kingdom of God is already at hand. I'm just joining God in the process. So really, you know, there's a book that was written a number of years ago. Now, this is my personal opinion. It was, you know, called The God Chaser. It's a great, great book. But I think a better title would be The God Responders. That we're not having to chase after God. God has chased us down. And that we're responding to him. And when we think in that way, it takes complete pressure off. Mm. And, you know, he's the one that gives the hunger. He's the one that gives this ability. And all we're doing is responding to him.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so that's, I think that's really the way. Just step out on the water.
No, that's good.
Go for it.
That's good. And any closing comments that you'd make to, you know, our audience here?
Yeah. You know, I would say this. Again, I'll go back to the very beginning of what I said. Very simple message. That the kingdom of God is at hand, no matter what. Our job is simply to look, listen, and respond. That we're to live out this message of the gospel in our everyday life, in a place of compassion, love, and power. That it's the word and the works. It's not just proclaiming something, it's demonstrating something. It's the show and the tell of the gospel. And you know what, it's okay to show and then tell as well too. Mm. So, and oftentimes we get that back, we say, no, you gotta proclaim. Well, sometimes my proclaim is this, God is really good. And we just, let me show you how good he is.
Yeah.
Mm. And sometimes we think we have to have these long, you know, messages and sermons, and man, just, if you can just say, hey, you know, God loves you. Look him straight in the eye and say, the Lord really loves you. He's proud of you. Can I pray for you? I mean, that right there in itself completely can wreck a person's heart, because it's the truth.
Mm.
Let me demonstrate. Say, Jesus, let your power come. And they begin to feel the presence of God. I mean, that's it. So it's proclaiming and it's demonstrating.
That's great. Yeah. That's great. Well, thanks for being with us. I really appreciate you sharing, you know, your stories, your journey, your wisdom with us. You know, just in closing, if you'd, it'd be great for you to just release and bless. I guess just, you know, even what's been imparted on your life, you know, from Blaine and from others, to those watching, just that it would multiply. And
absolutely. Well, it's an honor to get to pray for you. And listen, my prayer is this, is that you'd begin just to see how good God is, and that he is passionate about you, and he's passionate about using your life. And my heart and prayer for you is that you begin to see that the kingdom of God is at hand, no matter what or where, and that you'd begin just to look and listen and respond with complete passion and faith, that that God of the universe lives inside you, that Christ in you, the hope of glory. You know, Acts 10:38 says that Jesus went about destroying the works of the evil one because God had anointed him. Well, God's anointed you. God's anointed me to do that same thing. And so everybody gets to play. You get to play. And I just want to just release just a fresh empowerment and permission. And Lord, whatever you have given me, Lord, as freely as I received, I freely give it away. And so in the name of the Lord Jesus, be activated to look, to listen, to respond. Lord, I just ask for words and knowledge to begin to flow. Lord, I ask for just gifts of healing. Lord, ask right now, Lord, as they're watching this, they begin to feel the presence of the Lord come upon them. I just ask that you begin just that weighty presence. Some of you are beginning to feel like just a warmth coming into your hands, like a weighty presence. That's the Lord coming on you. That's the anointing of God coming on you. You're beginning to feel just this sensation or power tingling. That's the Lord saying, yes, here I am, permission. Now go and do the works. Go and proclaim the good news of the gospel because he's with you. The kingdom of God's at hand, no matter what.